professional aptitude. This diploma allows essentially that credibility, that traveling paper that will let any location that he appears knows that he has apprenticeship, he has some skills, and he's able to be hired in that particular location. Now, I'm going to discuss the stages of progression through the companionship or compagnonnage. The first stage is that of stagiaire. During the first year of the Tour de France, his title, also what we would say loosely as companion guest, he's a full-time worker in the trade. And he has a requirement to actually live in a common domicile, a home or the companion house. Next follows is a ceremony of adoption. In this stage, he has to start his work, and which is essentially a project that he must see to full mastership. His submission of this project makes him an aspirant. He can be adopted as such and receives a specific name within his body. And it's usually made up of the region where the man hails from. So for example, if an individual comes from Burgundy, France, he will be known as Bourguignon. He's also presented with a sash and a ceremonial walking stick representing the fact that they are constantly moving. They're never staying in the same location. Basically, they're itinerant workers. Once the aspirant has received that particular title, he starts now to work full-time on his trade. And he continues to work and live within the companion house. Now, he can go to other neighboring towns and villages and cities over the next 3 to 5 years, work in other fellow companions in order to really master his trade. At some point, he receives a reception ceremony where ultimately he presents his masterpiece, piece de resistance, right, to the board of companions. If this masterpiece is accepted, he now becomes officially an itinerant companion and receives his full companion name. He's also presented with a new walking stick, which now reaches to the height of his heart. It's in the relative term, as you can see in this figure here to the right. Now, during the 3 years of following his reception, he can go and pretty much work for those 3 particular years, touring all throughout France. And usually, to that point, to the end of his life, he becomes a sedentary companion, meaning there's no requirement to continue these tours. He can train others, and he can pretty much live and work wherever he wants, and essentially be, as we would say, probably grumpy old passmaster. Now, these images are designed in a way or provided in a way to let you see what a ceremony of reception looks like, what the Tour de France looks like, how pretty much companions are present day and in former years, how they are represented in a visual perspective. As you can see, there goes way, way, way back, not only with respect to being in the the 19th century, 20th century, and even before that with the companions walking in these processions with their walking sticks doing their tour. This particular slide illustrates one of the masterpieces that each companion, once they've completed their particular trials, have accomplished and are judged by the Board of Companionship. And as you can see, they're quite exquisite, quite intricate, and not necessarily something you can just do on a weekend. When I was in Paris a year and a half ago, I actually visited one of the companion locations, and you see here outside, it's the Companion Tour de France, and next to it is a library and museum. Now, we're going to go into other elements of companionship, which I think many of you may find to be interesting and somewhat unique. The companions actually have a legend. Their legend uses a biblical narrative which features their esoteric teachings and usually refers to Kings chapter 5 of the Bible, which speaks about the building of the temple, King Solomon, and describes 3 specific kinds of workers: carriers, builders, and leaders. The companion legend uses 3 mythological figures as well. King Solomon, who is told by his father to build his first temple, Master Jacques, who is the architect of the temple, and Father Subi, who is the second architect and friend of Master Jacques. Hiram is said to be the builder of the temple. He is known to be working in bronze and is filled with wisdom, understanding, and knowledge. each worker who is assigned to the building of this particular temple is paid according to their own particular merit and their value. And when received, their assignments are come down with respect to passwords that are developed by Hiram. It is also said that there were three particular apprentices within the companionship with the building of this particular temple who were felt to be unfit for initiation. They were Hallam, Sturkin, and Hurtafut. They made a plan to get the password from Hiram and killed him in their attempt. Later, they came back at night to dispose the body. They therein dug three particular holes, one for his clothes, one for his cane, and the other for his corpse. Nine companions, after finding out that Hiram was missing, was sent out to search and essentially found the sites by the presence of a branch of acacia. Solomon then ordered all the companions to shave their beards, cut their hair, and wear white aprons in mourning. They were also told to wear white gloves, indicating that they were innocent of the murder. And then he changed the password for certainty and had the three identified assailants punished and killed. Sounds familiar to some regard. There's another aspect of this legend where in another story, Jacques and Subi are actually very close friends and work together as tremendous architects in building this particular temple. Now, somewhere in the process, as good friends are, they got into arguments and had a physical fight. Now, the storyline goes that as a result of this fight, their apprenticeship or their particular groups got into it. So there were different workers led by Jacques and Subi, and their followers got hostile with each other because their masters were arguing and got into it with each other. And Subi's followers were said to have killed Jacques in that particular legend. And yet another myth concerns the split between the original companion movement into three distinct divisions. And each of these stories is often used to explain the origin of the three orders of companionage. The children of Solomon are considered to have been builders of the temple and that replaced the tabernacle for the Jews. The children of Master Jacques are also called compagnon passant or companions de devoir, who were later most concerned with the building of bridges. And the third were the children of Father Subi, who were later responsible for the construction of the big cathedral buildings in the great Romanesque style that we see quite often in Europe. Now, the point of today's conversation is around companionship and Freemasonry. And hopefully you may have seen a few things that distinctly have ring kind of too close to comfort or a little familiar. One of the questions that's often asked when discussing the French system of companionship is, what is their relationship with Freemasonry? To the uninitiated, the use of identical emblems such as the interlaced square and compasses reinforces that idea. Yes, my brothers. They use the square and compasses in the same manner in which we as Freemasons use and recognize as our emblems. So, in addition, their mysterious side of initiation, the elitism, for lack of a better word, the two organizations kind of induces some to believe that they're somehow two faces of the same society, the same secret organization. Some have actually a belief that this close relationship is actually one more so of genetic first cousins, whereas Freemasons and companions are somehow linked in that regard. Others even consider the possibility that one predated the other, and possibly because we know companionship existed in France before Masonry got to France in the context in which we know it, that Freemasonry may have borrowed from companionship. Now, I'm illustrating examples of the interlaced square and compasses, which is important because as we look through these images, quite often brothers would say, especially Masonic brothers, if they see these images, that, oh, this must be something Masonic. And they're actually not. They're marking specifically in some of these graves and other artifacts that of members within a companionship in France. Also images of how the companions dressed, both in that time, and as you see, there'll be some more contemporary images that you can explore. But if you notice, in this particular scenario, there's an apron being worn, but the distinctive sash and the distinctive canes are often seen throughout the different styles of companions that existed. Now, the issue of dual membership comes into play. And I bring it up because Masonic and companionship obediences in France actually visibly did not interact. Many companions, especially around the Vichy period, this is around the time where you had the Nazi take control of France, actually had an anti-Masonic tinge and a negative attitude towards Freemasonry. However, in a large number of companionship, we found that while dual affiliation was strictly prohibited and any discovery would lead to the expulsion of a companion who was also a Freemason, in others, it was actually up to the individual's discretion. So as a companion, I could actually become a dual member of a Freemasonic lodge. So we know that it's fairly well known in the mid-19th century that there was also the desire for companions to foster fraternal friendliness based on the fact that, hey, we have the same symbols. So we must at least have some commonality and a reason for us to be friendly. It was also seen by the fact that companions who were completing their Tour de France and traveling all across France, for example, would have had more contact with Freemasons in those particular locations, towns, cities, etc., within their social circles. And because of the itinerant nature of their work and needing to network and find jobs or find opportunities for work, that it would make sense for them to amplify the opportunities by becoming members of both organizations. Now, companions in the early 19th century also use that as that mutual beneficial assistance, whereas if I find myself destitute or in need of some help, I can double up my chances of receiving that aid by virtue of not only being a companion but also being a Freemason. And we also know that by entry into Freemasonry with military lodges, that there were a number of men and companions and Freemasons who served in these armed forces and as a result had that opportunity to mix and mingle. Now, the other similarities, as I kind of talked about the basic emblem of the square, ruler, and interlaced compasses, illustrates some elements that, as we felt, of how these operative guilds, as we call them, operated before the arrival of Freemasonry in France. But it's also important to note that while some may look at this as an indication of influence, there's even less evidence to say that there's a companionship origin to Freemasonry. Basically, it's up in the air. Companions, like Freemasons, tend to use the particular symbol that we hold near and dear, which is the fifth liberal art of geometry. And it's a fundamental underlying principle seen in both organizations. Why? If you consider this as an important symbol of the start of this organic relationship, then it's one of those signs that we say talks about that common substrate of architecture being how we build our organization, how we build our moral lessons, both within the Freemasonic world and in the companionship world. These same geometrical instruments were also publicly used, as we know, and taught those same moral lessons that we, as Masons nowadays, associate only within our organization and not recognizing that they were part of a larger, more publicly available tool for learning and understanding and knowledge. And what's even more troubling for Masons, there are a few excerpts that were found where companionship rituals mentioned specifically that show a match almost with some of the French rituals at that time, especially that of the French Rite that was practiced in the Grand Orient of France. Companions also sought to give their rites and their legends the fashion, the mentality, the enrichment that was quite similar to that of the Masonic elements. In fact, right before 1870, we find a letter by Jules Napoleon Bastet, who was a companion tanner, who later became a Freemason, that spoke about specific reforms that he wanted to introduce to his companionship society, to kind of highlight and heighten the experience in the receptions, and also, I would say, fashion some of the influences that he saw with Freemasonry. And permit me to just read this for a second. What do we have to be able to teach a man? Nothing. Our writings are not quite complicated enough. It lacks great things. What will it take? A well-written book containing the details from which companionship companies stem, the rank of each body of the state, boost our reception, increase our recognition? Let us walk in the footsteps of Masons without mimicking their principles, as there is nothing to borrow from them. For our receptions, witnessing it in a suitable setting, that is to say, in a frock coat, a tall hat fitted with our colors of a decent upgrade. Also, to have the blue apron embroidered with white and red. Our tools will be above the two columns of the temple, and the compasses in the square, and the transparent representation of the two pillars of the temple, the olive branch, a compass, and a square, the dog of Perignon, the tomb behind the veil. All the companions sitting and the first in the city will interview the recipient, will introduce with a spin, blindfolded in a chamber, only the will left to write on these reflections, having before him a coffin covered with a pail and two white colors representing the cross, two rods above the coffin, a pistol, a dagger, the sun and the moon painted on glass in a form of a lantern. That is a country that we need. These are elements of both writings, journals, and articles written by companions. And here you see more modern day companions, in some respect, their companion devoir, who are about to embark on their tour de France. Other folks, other companions, we see in present day France. And we're going to take a little, shout out to the old school way the companions dressed at the time, which was quite as colorful as they are today. Here are other images of the companions and the different styles of companions that existed in the different companies. Now, I speak about the common cultural substrate for one particular reason. While we look at Freemasonry and try to compare who came first or the chicken and the egg approach, it's not to consider and oftentimes caution brothers from trying to always say there's an absolute beginning and an end to how these groups either came about or how they're linked. It's more appropriate to speak of dualities or even plurality in how the various operative guilds grew in history. And the problem is to not to be obsessed over the ritual and the kinship or the linkages between, but to better identify and understand that there is a common cultural operative substrate to all of these organizations, whether or not they have a similar initiatic character, or whether it's the fact of the focus on the trades, the arts, and related sciences. And with that, I would say merci, thank you, with the nod to Brother Jean-Michel Matonnier, who was the director of the Center of the Study of Companions in Avignon, France, who assisted me in getting the information in French so I could translate it for the purposes of today's presentation.
Well, let's take a short break, and we'll set up the tables for questions, and we can ask Brother Allen here about any questions that his presentation may have brought to mind. So let's reconvene around 2 o'clock. So Oscar, are you in the house here? We need you front and center. There he is. And the rest of the committee? Is in the PR office. Since Seth wasn't here, they weren't able to get it. But Rich knows about that, and he's gonna make sure that doesn't happen again. So. All right.
Learn not to come look for me. Just yell my name.
Yeah. So Mike and Ben, we request your presence up here.
Mike's hurt.
Oh, okay. Mike, you don't have to come if you don't.
Mike's been forgiven.
Well, we have the same setup this afternoon as we had this morning. We have men in the aisles with microphones, and if you want to ask a question, raise your hand, state your name and your lodge affiliation, and we'll do our best to answer it. Any questions? There we go.
Okay. Hello. Rick Rissinger, York Lodge number 266. For the French Companion presentation, you had covered that there was a little disparagement between the Freemasons and the Companions. But what about amongst the different groups within the Companions themselves, like between the painters, the tanners, the woodworkers, and so forth? Did they work together amicably, or were they still kind of isolated amongst their individual occupations?
Great question. Can you hear me? Great question. Is this on? Can you hear me? Okay. Thanks again for that question. As with most groups, they had their sense of pride and their sense of, I would say, arrogance. We did find in doing this research in the groups that exist now, they do interact with each other. They didn't necessarily have an acrimonious relationship between each other. I mean, obviously, they had their houses, if I can use that term loosely. But they were cordial in that regard because, similarly, while they focused on a particular companion tanner, companion leather smith, companion tailor, they were not necessarily in acrimony. So the relationship with respect to the companions within the companionship order was relatively amicable and still is.
Down front.
Walter Flores, Concordia Lodge 67. I have a question about the last picture you had up. I saw two pillars. I just wanted to know, besides the square and compass, what other symbols did they actually have that were similar to the Masonic ones that we see?
Yep. Thank you. If you noticed, as I was reading the letter that was written in 1870, there are a couple things that would be very familiar to the Masonic world. So the pillars, the square and compasses, as was mentioned, the fact that they had a chamber of reflection, the other elements, the emblems of mortality, if I can use it, because I know we have an open open mic here. They also had, if you looked at some of those tools that were on the tombstones and in some of the buildings, oftentimes many of the tools that we don't have in American Freemasonry but exist outside in other countries, such as the chisel, the mallet, these were elements that they use,
tied, of course, to that operative connection, and that we know exists in other Masonic grand jurisdictions. It's just that we don't use them here in the U.S., nor have they been adopted as formal tools in American Freemasonry. But they were very similar tools that we would find and have found that exist in other Masonic jurisdictions outside of the U.S., predominantly that of the mallet, the chisel, and a few other implements that one would see in the operative Masonic world, saws, things of that nature, but still having a moral lesson behind them.
Down front.
My name is Greg Watts from Shiloh McCall Lodge, number 558 in Satterton, Pennsylvania. I have a couple questions. First off, is this fraternity isolated to France? Does it extend beyond the borders of France or even in the Americas? And also, what does this fraternity look like today? I noticed that there were females in some of the pictures. It seems like they are quite active currently from what it looks. Could you just describe that to us?
Yes. Thank you. So there are a couple of things, and a few of the brothers had asked me questions in our intermittent break with respect to other countries and whether or not companionships existed in others. They are predominantly French in that regard, but it's not to say those places where French individuals moved to that they did not continue their companionship interaction or the spirit of keeping their fraternal links current. We know that there are a few companionship organizations in the U.S. In New York, there's actually a companionship association. They don't do the outward presentation of doing the Tour de France like you would see in France or parts of France now, and they're kind of made theirs much more of a social professional organization in that regard of French expatriates or individuals who have a French heritage. The other components that I also mentioned to a few brothers that you look at Germany, which also had a significant operative guild that one could argue predated that of the Masonic presence and is still active to this day. They and other groups like that kept and maintained, I guess, the integrity of the organization. To your question around the demographics and the current activity, companionship in relationship to what they were in the past did have a contraction where the members and the size of the organization got much smaller. Of course, with the advent of industrialization and these other elements, the computerized technology, we saw, a shift with respect to those who are going into trades. Because fundamentally, at the bottom level, if you think about it, this was a trade association or trade organization because while you learned those moral lessons that we see within our Masonic realm, you actually graduated out of this organization with the ability to work and be employed and to build things. So they were being itinerant and moving around from place to place looking for jobs. The contraction that happened would have been surrounding the industrialization or the movement away of the large edifices is being built. They're still active in many parts of France, as you saw in a number of the photos that I provided. They are some companions that are co-ed. Majority of them are co-ed now, whereas before the older pictures would show kind of the companionship mother, meaning a woman who ran the particular household where they all lived in a common, kind of like a common fraternity house. But they have been evidence shown that they were women companions earlier on, and even now to this present day, there are lots of women companions. So it's there is a resurgence of interest in the companionship, and we see this when you start to look at many of the websites and the museums and the conversations that people have, and the revelation of a lot of the rituals and the understanding of that operative transition into the speculative world and into contemporary world of France. So there's a lot more information being found, and I would say that they are an interesting group and possibly I don't know whether or not they will ever set foot, meaning to form chapters here in the U.S., but there's a lot of interest in learning more about the companionship world.
Brian Versetti, Omni Lodge number 582. You mentioned the word companion, and for the open mic reason, York Wright, we have companions. Did you find any correlation between those two by chance?
I'm glad you asked that, because a lot of folks first thought when I when the topic was about co-masonry in hearing the word co. The term companion, and that's one of the reasons why I broke down the description or the definition of it, that of tradesman, craftsman. One could see there's an association that could either be perceived or, how do I say this, that exists. Whether or not there's a link, meaning, or the term that we use in Freemasonry to show companionship, which is predominantly in the York Rite, in comparison to the fact that they, at the outset, call themselves companions, what is the link between that? What is the source? Did it come from each other? It's hard to say that you're seeing a direct one-to-one link, or two organizations or multiple organizations organically growing out of that same kind of historical and common framework. So if you are doing work and you have someone as an apprentice that you're working with as a partner, as a fellow student, you know, that is that individual companion? Is it a common phrase that was used that therefore continued through the course of our development as a society and as a culture? That's one avenue. I can't and I haven't been able to specifically and definitively say that the use of the term companion in the Masonic realm is directly tied to the French use of the companion, but there are some natural indication as to why it may have occurred.
Hi, Scott Cattleman, Hackenberg, Mount Moriah Lodge, number 19, Philadelphia. Actually have two questions. The first is there any, for instance, in France, are many Freemasons, have they joined the companions and vice versa? Are they mutually exclusive? And my other question, which is just something you just touched on a few minutes ago, you mentioned Germany, other companion-type organizations in the world. Could you just briefly touch a little bit more on them and how they relate to Freemasonry?
Okay. So there was a period of time in the German occupation of France where certain companion groups did not mix it with the Masonic groups, mainly because there was a significant anti-Masonic tinge by virtue of the Nazi occupation, and more specifically, since there was a great focus on Freemasonry, it really did not bode well for one to be associated with that particular group. So also because of that time, there was that political strife back and forth. The Vichy period of France, where that government was essentially in cahoots with the occupying forces, the discord between the two organizations was apparent. There are other avenues or other locations where that wasn't the case, where you can join and be a dual member. In present day, you have a number of individuals who are members of both, and you have other individuals who are not, who are solely in one. For example, the director of the study for French companionship in Avignon, Jean-Michel Matonnier, he has been a very good friend, significantly interesting researcher, but he is not a Freemason. But he's still been able to present much of his work and a lot of this research at, most of the time, either companionship or significantly a huge interest in the Masonic world because of the fact that Masons have this desire to find out what are the particular links that exist. And finding out who else is doing what essentially we seem to be doing the same in similar vein. The other groups in Germany, and forgive me, normally I would be able to roll it off my tongue, but it's a much longer syllable, but there's a group that exists in Germany and still exists to this day that one could say is quite similar to the development of how the French with companionship, they also in Germany had a number of guilds that have drone and have essentially this operative slash speculative component that also exists and still can be studied. One of the other questions brothers had asked me was how did I even start to figure out this particular topic? And it ties into your particular question, brother. Part of it was trying to identify what was the source of when did Freemasonry develop or own the square and compasses. First, we, as an American Freemason, we need to recognize that the G doesn't exist in other countries with respect to the square and compasses. That led me to go into, of course, where we see the Freemasonic organization growing, and lo and behold, here's this group that's using the square and compasses, but they're not Masons. So my first comment was, how is that allowed? I was pointed to the AQC, the oldest research lodge in England, and in their first journal, in their first transaction, there's actually a paper on French companionship, because even back then, they were interested in finding out what are the potential links and where, how did the two tie into each other with respect to Freemasonry and companionship. So the whole window opened up by virtue of reading and looking up at these old documents and historical papers, and then finding out that they're a thriving entity that exists, and of course seeing some of the other groups such as the Germans, etc., and recognizing that the world is bigger than what we can imagine with respect to our own fraternity, and the ability to improve our awareness about it is of paramount importance. And that's why I've been working with Jean-Michel to figure out how to get much more of this information in the hands, or at least to the awareness of the American Freemason, so that we can expand our breadth and depth of knowledge as well.
My brother, I wanted to ask you about how would you relate Sufism to this companionship program? I read a book called The Secret Practices of the Sufi Freemasons, and it talks about alchemy and different types of exercises that were done by Oriental Freemasons, which a lot of modern Freemasonry has forgotten to a certain extent. So how would you compare Sufism and some of their spiritual orders to this companionship program?
So those who may not know, Sufism is an aspect of, a mystical aspect of Islam, much as you would have, I would say, other elements like in Judaism, you have the Kabbalah, esotericism, etc. Now, the interesting thing about Sufism, there's some parallels that one could see and even make some associations with. The Sufis are taught that no matter where they may live, to adopt the customs and traditions of the country in which, and the rules of which they may find themselves to be under. So essentially be good citizens and obey the laws and rules of the land in which they find themselves, which is quite similar to what we see in Freemasonry, and very similar to what we see in many of these particular orders, such as these operative groups like the Companionship, as well as the group in Germany. Whereas the desire, as you go out and you learn and you interface and you become a good citizen, you obey the rules and customs of the land which you serve, and you try your best to don't disturb things, but in some way, shape, or form, be beneficial additions or beneficial contributors to the society and the culture. Specifically around Sufism and their particular lessons and esoteric and I would say philosophical bearings, it's as with any other inner orders or groups who try to focus on the self and the philosophical self, you're seeing much more of the as we would term it, the speculative aspect of taking lessons, philosophies, understanding, and inculcating them within you as an individual, and how you can be a better contributor to the world and to others around you, essentially, and pardon me for coining this common phrase, but as a good man, making yourself a better man, and thusly improving the world in which you live.
Benjamin Littman, Senior Warden, Shiloh McCall Lodge, number 558. My question is for Ben. With Harrison's devices, H1 through H5, with very little support or no support from copyright and patent laws. How is he able to protect the integrity of his inventions from either being stolen or copied or tampered with so that they wouldn't interfere with more popular people in the rural society?
That is a great question. I think that there were probably some sort of, that's a great question. I think that there were probably some rudimentary proprietary laws around creative products. But I think the real answer is probably, and I'm speculating here, is probably because no one knew how to build it. Harrison, they needed Harrison. And they may have taken the one that they locked up in that safe and duplicated it painstakingly after his death. And I'm sure as he got older, in fact, I know he was using other watchmakers to build his designs, and he had drawn them out on paper. So I think that would have been a kind of rudimentary type of patent, if you will. You would need to share that blueprint. And after he did sell it, or the board acquired it after his death, I'm pretty sure that's how K1 through 3 or whatever they were actually developed. But that's a good question. And as a patent guy, I should really know definitively the state of the law, but I don't at that time.
We have a question from the internet for Brother Alan. This comes from the brothers down at Cashew Mount Horeb Lodge in Ardmore. They would like to know, let me cue this up, pardon me. Did companionship in Freemasonry both experience a decline due to Catholicism in France, or is French companionship looked upon more favorably by the church?
So, with respect to the French companionship, I'll underscore it this way. It was more so a focus on being essentially an occupational benefit from being a member of this particular group. You, if you were a builder, if you were a painter, if you were a tanner, a tailor, all the different elements that a shoemaker, these were all elements that were important as far as trades are concerned. So the membership in the companionship would not have necessarily been at odds with those who were within certain religious customs, etc. I would say the question around the issues or the impacts of Catholicism, as you know, with the whole issues of the French Revolution, their take of the impact of the church and the rise of secularism has a much different perspective than what we in our American or even in the English customs can truly understand or truly appreciate. But I would say the first aspect of the answer to the question is, by virtue of it being a trade-related organization where the benefits of membership was associated to individuals who were able to gain employment and be productive builders or tradesmen providing value to the communities and cities they serve, there was not a great degree of issue with membership an attestation or a focus against their membership by virtue of religious authority.
Yeah, Oscar, if I could follow up on that question. I know that the Catholic Church's opposition to Masonry often has to do with their claiming that we should use reason to acquire knowledge and explicitly denounce sort of knowledge by authority. Mm-hmm. You have to find out for yourself. I mean, so maybe one of the differences between companionship and Freemasonry is this emphasis on knowledge and how you acquire it.
And I would say more so the fact that you are gaining your skills and your apprenticeship and the entire Tour de France was celebrated, was a parade through, that you would know the companions are coming to town or leaving town. So there was that spirit of celebration where in this case, a young man would go set up to get an apprenticeship to start to learn to build those masterpieces. As I was telling a few brothers in the break, the ability to create that masterpiece, whether or not it's a structure as you would build a Romanesque church or some other elements, to create something from your hands, I think is We're selling it short in some regard because from our perspective, we focus, of course, on the speculative aspect of Freemasonry in the philosophical. Theirs was much more of that duality, that blending of understanding why those moral lessons, but these are going to be helpful for you to learn your trade, focus on your trade, take the elements that are given to you and fashion them in a way into something physical that's going to benefit society. So you're going to play a role in building this church, this government office, or clothing or shoes that people can walk, you know, that you essentially are providing a direct benefit to society. So the focus on the philosophical is of interest to us in that regard as American Freemasons. Our focus has been on the speculative side. We each have our independent trade, so yes, there are only a few of us that I would say are actually bricklayers or those types of occupations, but we have the benefit of separating them out in that regard. Theirs was tied to their occupation and how they would live their lives, being contributors to society by virtue of their trade and their work.
Any more questions? Well, if not, let me thank the speakers for a wonderful day of information and enlightenment. I appreciate your being with us and sharing your knowledge.
Thank you.
And actually, in token of our appreciation for your contribution, we have a plaque that has your name on it, as well as the medallion for the Academy of Masonic Knowledge. And Oscar, let me.
Thank you.
And Brother Ben?
Thank you. Thank you, Seth.
You
appreciate it. Thank you.
Cheers. That's great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
And our closing today will be given by Erastus Allen.
My brothers, as today's Academy of Masonic Knowledge program comes to a close, let us take this opportunity to reflect on the day we have shared together and consider how to apply what we've experienced. The Academy provides important opportunities to Freemasons in Pennsylvania, and I'd like to highlight three of these for your consideration. It is an opportunity to encounter new ideas. Let us make use of these ideas in our own research and to spark the light of Masonic inquiry in others. The Academy is an opportunity to make new connections. Let us consider how to use these connections to extend the conversation locally, perhaps a lodge book club. Or let us use these connections to maintain periodic contact with brothers across the jurisdiction with whom we would not otherwise have that opportunity. Finally, the Academy provides an opportunity to be inspired. Let us use this inspiration to drive our own Masonic inquiry, to form good habits in our studies, to broaden our search beyond our common trivia, to answer the important questions of our lives. William Preston wrote that our Masonic study does not require us to learn everything, as that would be a stupendous undertaking, but we are to be capable of admitting every new discovery. In this spirit of learning how to learn, let us continue our work meaningfully ourselves until we welcome the chance to gather together in Masonic fellowship here at the Academy of Masonic Knowledge again. Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Erastus. That's pretty good for extemporaneous. Well, brother, safe travels. We're so happy you were able to join us today. We look forward to seeing you at future meetings of the Academy of Masonic Knowledge. Godspeed.